One of the most common and ancient practices that humanity has is to sit by the fire. Well, for us, it's nostalgia, or it's not necessary, really. It's something we want to do. Do you like to sit by the fire? Well, you might have a fireplace in your house, a fire pit in your backyard, but have you really been on the beach in the cold, or in the mountains, or in the woods, and had to have a fire? You had to have a fire to cook your food. When I was in Africa and Cameroon, all of my meals were cooked over a wood fire in a separate building. We need it for warmth. I always mentioned to Linda, I would like to go snow camping sometime. And she says, not a chance. But then you have to have a fire. You need it for safety. I so admire the pioneers of our country, and not only here, but around the world, who, in amazing ways, lived by the fire. And then when they built log cabins, they brought the fire inside into the fireplace, into the hearth, and had these big stones around the hearth. You know, there for a reason. The fire warms them up, and they radiate heat all night. They need it for safety. Fire is a safety keep. You hope that the beast in the forest stay away from the fire. And the fire lasts long enough so you can get a good night's sleep. And probably even more importantly than that, for food, for warmth, for safety, generations after generations in every country around the world, people have sat by the fire. And we need to. It's so wonderful, but one of the most important things that happens at the fire is the storytelling. The conversation that happens at a fire that you don't have anywhere else, really. Something happens to you when you see the flames flicker and light the faces of those around the fireplace. We often turn our fireplace on and shut every other light in the house off because I love to see the flames flicker in the face and the eyes of one you love. And then you talk. You tell stories. And that's important. That's food for the soul. That's protection for your mind and soul. It's so important. We're losing that, unfortunately. The warm fire in the fireplace or a fire pit or the fire campfire, sometimes it's giving way to the little blue lights that's in your face off your phone. Don't lose the fire. You need the fire. Robert Moffat was an explorer of Africa, Congo and other areas. And he was giving a lecture. He loved Christ. He was no preacher. He was just an explorer. But he was giving a lecture in a small lecture hall in England. And in that audience was a young man, a medical student. But Robert Moffat said that on occasion, he could go back into his mind and see the smoke of 1,000 fires in 1,000 villages rising in the night air in Africa. It's nostalgic. And that resonated in the heart of David Livingstone, who forgot everything, went to Africa to minister and explore. The smoke of 1,000 villages. Can you see that? While eating in the little dining hall in Cameroon, and the cooks are just busy serving us, and as they go by, I get the scent of the mahogany wood that they burn for the fire. You wouldn't think about burning mahogany here, but that's what they have. So I grabbed one of the cook's hands and said, sit with us. And she smiled a big smile, and that whole area you could smell the cook fire as her cologne, as her scent. It was wonderful. We need to come to the fire. It's nostalgia for us, really, because we don't really need to have a campfire. We don't really need to have a fireplace. But there's something in our DNA that loves to sit by the fire. We really do. And we want those times when we hear the stories that we tell one another. Those are important. Jesus, our Lord, no doubt sat at many fires. He sat with his 12, later the 11. Many, many times he sat at the fireplace. Wouldn't you like to have been in that number so you could have heard the conversation? We just get a smattering of what everything Jesus said. That's what John said. Jesus said many, many other things. And I think many of those things were said around the fireplace, around the fire, as they cooked their bread or roasted their fish. But in John chapter 21, we have one of those wonderful times when Jesus is by the fire with his disciples. John chapter 21. Oh, you know the story. Uncle read it to us. The disciples are out fishing all night long. And they get nothing. And they're tired. And they're hungry. And they're empty. They have no fish to prove that they've been anywhere. And Jesus says to them, have you caught anything? No, they said. Throw your net on the other side, says the Lord. And they caught fish. Not an unusual thing. They had spotters on the bank a lot of times. Jesus washed the feet of the disciples. He spotted fish for them. He showed them, what are you talking about? You're a carpenter. I'm the fisherman, Peter might have said. But no. At your word, they cast the net. They caught the fish. And that figure on the bank in the pre-dawn light is standing next to a glowing fire. And John sized him up and says, that's the Lord. Peter jumped into the water and swam to the bank. You know, while he's swimming, I'm sure he's thinking about the three times he denied Jesus. Wow. He's got a reckoning coming. But he loves Jesus. And so he comes. And they sat around this pre-made fire with bread already provided and fish had already been roasted. Not only did Jesus wash the feet of the disciples, he spotted fish for them. Now he cooks them breakfast. Do you think Jesus went to the bank and snapped his finger and the fire appeared? No. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 2 that he was made in all points like we are. We are his family, and he is ours. Jesus in the pre-dawn hours, collected the wood. He obtained the fish. He lit the fire. He made the bread or bought the bread. It was ready for them. These tired, hungry men, as the dawn began to lighten the sky, and they smell the aroma of the fish and the bread. Jesus served his disciples fillet of fish sandwiches on the beach. How wonderful is that? He did this himself. He had no servants, he was the servant. He once said that he that is great among you, let him be the servant of all, and that's who he was and is, our Lord Jesus. When they had landed, go back one. When they had landed, they saw a fire burning coals there with fish and some bread. And Jesus said, "Have you caught any fish? We'll bring some of the fish." And then he says later to them, "Come, have breakfast." And the Greek word there is the word breakfast. Jesus served them breakfast on the beach in that beautiful setting that he made himself. And he took the bread, and he took the fish, and he served them. Don't let that go by you. Nobody got up and volunteered to serve the others. He got up and served them. He gathered the wood, he made the fire, he obtained the fish and the bread, and then he got it all together for them. So they'd sat by the fire, and he fed them. It's a perfect picture of all that Jesus has done for us. You know, we can add very little to what Jesus has done. If I serve God in any way, it's his gift to me, not mine to him. Jesus lays out the breakfast. And as the smoke rises into the air, somebody throws a log on the fire, the cinders raise into the sky, the smell of the smoke, and Jesus breaks the silence. He looked at all of those men, every one of them. But he comes to Peter. "Peter, son of John, do you love me?" How many times did Peter deny Jesus? Three times. Now Jesus is going to ask Peter three times. "Peter, do you love me?" You know, you and I need to sit at the fire and hear those same words. "John, do you love me?" "Oh, I'm a preacher in a Baptist church. I was raised in a Southern Baptist. Now I'm preaching at a community church and I'm serving." No, Jesus said, "John, do you love me? Do you love me?" And the word that Jesus uses there is agapikos, agape, agape, agapatos. Do you love me with deep, godly love? Self-sacrificial love, Peter. Do you love me? And then Peter answers him. He says, "Yes, Lord, I love you like a brother." He's a completely different word. Phileos. I have affection for you. "Peter, do you love me with God's love?" "Well, I count you as a friend." That's what he said. And then Jesus looks at the other, he comes back to Peter and says, "But Peter, son of John, do you love me?" And again, Peter says, "Lord, I have affection for you. Phileos, I have affection for you." not the question Jesus asked. Do you have deep, spiritual, godly, self-sacrificing love for me? Do you love me more than these? Now, you remember just a few hours before, Peter, Jesus said, you're all going to deny me. And Peter said, not me. These other 11 over here, they may all leave you, but I'm going to stand by you. Didn't happen. Peter, do you love me more than these? You said you did. Jesus was taking Peter out of his high perch of self-righteousness and taking him and plopping him down with the other 11. He's just like these guys too. You know, we need to be humble about our relationship with God, don't we? I have failed Jesus so many ways, so many times. John, do you love me? He says to me by the fire. And then Peter's hurt. He's upset and he says, Lord, you know everything. You know I have deep affection for you. And then three times Jesus says, feed my lambs. Feed my sheep. If you love me, if you even have affection for me, the last time Jesus said, do you love me? He said, use the same word Peter used. Peter, do you even love me like a brother? Feed my sheep. Peter, I'm not going to be here much longer. You're going to meet some sheep down the road here. Some of them are going to be smelly. Some of them are going to be mean. Some of them be cranky. You're going to have to feed them anyway. Feed my sheep. Bring them into the safe fold, Peter. That's how you love me. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. Can you hear that? Does that resonate in your soul? As you warm yourself by the fire of Jesus. It's not about church. It's not about doctrine. It's not about any of that. It's about our relationship with Jesus. Do you love Jesus? Do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. And we might add, but not enough. Help me love you more. And so Jesus reinstates Peter. He denied Jesus three times. Now he affirms his love for Jesus, albeit not perfectly, three times. Peter is now reinstated as one of the apostles, one of the disciples. I deserve to be on the outside. So do you. But Jesus reinstates me and you when we fail. When we fall on our face, Jesus picks us up, dusts us off, sits us by the fire and says, do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. I want to love you more. How wonderful is this? To love Jesus. I have several scriptures up here, but I just don't want to spend a lot of time on this because I want to hear the gal sing again, don't you? John says, now this is way past this. You know, when Jesus is sitting at the fire and standing on the bank, they knew him but didn't know him. They recognized him, but didn't recognize him. He's different. He's resurrected. The cross is gone. He's finished his work. He's at that place of completion. He's changed. He's still the Lord. You know, Jesus is always going to be human. Always. That's the great mystery of the Trinity. How God could be pleased that all his fullness could be in a human form. Jesus, our Lord. We need to sit at the feet of Jesus. The breakfast is ready. We can't add anything to it. I see in here a couple of things. John says that which was from the beginning, we saw it, we felt it, we heard it, we touched it, we felt the fabric of his garment, we heard the resonance of his voice, and we felt the magnetism of his love drawing us in. This was experiential. In my office, preparing for this, I stopped and said, Lord Jesus, are we still friends? Do I really love you? I love you, Lord. The girl sang it so well. I love you, Lord. Open my eyes, Lord. I want to see Jesus. Just a couple of things here. Consider the warmth of the humanity of Jesus. Think of the warmth of who he is, the utter kindness, the utter sweetness, the utter acceptance, the warmth of Jesus that takes us in. He takes us in when we don't deserve a moment. He lays breakfast before us. The human, it says in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 to the end of the chapter, read it. Jesus had to be made like his brothers in every aspect. That's why I know he gathered the wood and made the fire. So that he could be one family with us. Beloved, take nothing home but this. When we come here together in this place, this is family. I talked to a young man the other day, he didn't have a family. I said, there is somebody that's your family. The Lord Jesus wants to cover you. He wants to bring you into his family. We are family. We should love one another. Heaven knows we're going to get beat up outside. Shouldn't happen here. We should love as a family. Now, some of your family members, you know, you say, Uncle Joe coming to Thanksgiving dinner. Oh no, not again. But you love the family. Maybe he's got a story to tell at the table. The utter kindness and humanity and warmth of Jesus. And think of this. Consider the depth of his grace. He fed, washed the feet, and helped them catch fish of the people who denied him, broke their promises. But he loved them. To such a depth and to such a grace. You know, beloved, I really believe this, that most Christians don't have a clue, as they should, about the depth of the grace of Jesus. He loves you with a grace that is deeper than the universe itself. The depth of the grace of Jesus took errant, denying, cursing Peter brushed him off and reinstated him back into these disciples. Thank you, Lord. Consider this also. Consider the breadth of Christ's love. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and deep. It shall forevermore endure, as songs and angels. The love of God, how rich and pure. Most of our love is tainted with something else. But there's bright moments when the love of God wraps itself around your heart and you're loving like God loves. It's an experience that you will never forget. It doesn't matter what you receive. You love somebody to a depth. Only Jesus can make you do that. We're so selfish. You look at that sleeping face of that child or your mate. You study them and you say to yourself, my, how I love this person. God loves you the same. And think, consider the life in Christ's deity. Normally we think about the deity of Christ being powerful, but it sparkles with life. The deity of Jesus, John says, look at this. I'm just telling you, I've got to tell you, we have seen the life. That's what he says in John chapter 1. The life appeared. We saw it. It sparkled with life and vibrancy and glory. The life. The life, not the rules. The life, not the religion. The life. The life of Jesus is the deity of who he is. I tell you that the life of Jesus sparkles with power. And John, the life appeared, we saw it. We touched it, we heard it. It was Jesus, our Lord. Beloved, I want that life, don't you? Eternal life. It's not just living forever on golden streets in mansions. That's good. Eternal life is the quality of life that you have in you right now from the Holy Spirit that gives you eternal life today. Now is your eternal life. It should sparkle with power. In vibrancy. And nothing dark can stand in its presence. Because it is the life of the deity of Christ. Ever present in us. And so, beloved, when you and I get together in this place, we have that promise. Where two or three are gathered together, I am in the midst of them. In all of his love, and all of his grace, and all of its sparkling life is here with us whenever we meet. Take it. Hold it. Love it. Rejoice in it. Rejoice in the eternal life that you have now. It's so wonderful to know Jesus. And so here we are at the fire. The breakfast is over. And Jesus' eyes scan his disciples, and he says to them, Do you love me? Pray with me. We just stand amazed at the sparkling life and power and grace and love of the Lord Jesus. We do love you, Lord. Thank you. Would you just open your heart right now to that love? Just open. Lord, I receive you into my life right now. Come be my Lord. Take my sin forgiven and bring the sparkling life of eternal life inside of me. I love you, Lord. Thank you. Can we all say amen? Henry?
Feel the world is tumbling down.